Bodies of babies from a fetal age of 35 weeks to toddlers who were aged up to 3. Bodies left beneath the unmarked ground. What kind of country and society would have allowed for those babies and children to have been put there, leaving behind undoubtedly many broken and bereft mothers? And just how do we respond now? In our audience tonight, we meet people who are still searching for answers about their mothers, their brothers and their sisters. Also tonight, the birth mother of Grace, who was left in a foster home for years after allegations of sexual abuse came to light, speaks out for the first time. Hello and welcome to the programme. The painful truth is that we now know the tiny bodies of babies and young children were discarded beneath the grounds of a mother and baby home in Tuam. Once again, as a nation, we are saddened and we're shamed, but survivors groups say bodies at Tuam are just the tip of the iceberg and that there may be thousands more bodies buried beneath other institutions across the country. I want to come first to Cathy McMahon, who's here from the Irish First Mothers Group. Cathy, tell me first of all what your group are seeking, because you want more information from the Children's Minister, Catherine Zappone.
Irish First Mothers have called for information in relation to the exact number of bodies that have been found in Tuam. And we're also calling for examination of other grounds, particularly the grounds of homes where babies were born on site. For instance, St. Patrick's Home on the Navan Road, and other people will know of other homes, but St. Patrick's on the Navan Road, Besborough, and any other home where babies were born on site.
Do you, when you make that call for the exact numbers to be released, do you believe that that information is available to the Commission? Because it may not be at this point in time.
I don't know is the honest answer, but having been a mother who was incarcerated in St. Patrick's on the Navan Road on my second child, I do believe that there is a need for St. Patrick's. And because of the interaction within our group and the mothers who are in our group that were incarcerated in Besborough, I believe that there is a huge need for the grounds of Besborough to be examined.
Okay, let's go back to your first child. Mm-hmm. Your first child was born in 1974.
74.
Tell us what happened at that time, Cathy.
Well, in 1973, I became pregnant. 74, just after Christmas, I was delivered to Dunboyne. We're at Good Shepherd Convent, Dunboyne, in Dunboyne. And I stayed there for 4 months. When I went into labour, I was delivered to Hollis Street Hospital on the 26th of April. And my daughter was born.
How old were you?
I was just gone 18.
And what happened to your daughter?
I nursed her for 7 days. And the day I was being discharged from the hospital, I dressed my baby, and as I turned to prepare myself and I turned back, the nurse was leaving the room with my baby.
Had you been told during your pregnancy that that's what was going to happen?
I wasn't told that she'd be swiped the way she was swiped. I knew it was never discussed, but the atmosphere, you know, being put in a mother and baby home to conceal the pregnancy, there was no way was I bringing my baby home. Also, during my time in Dunboyne, after I contacted the father of my child, a priest came to Dunboyne, who I'd never met before, to tell me that I had basically set the father of my child astray, that I was looking to ruin his life, and that the baby that I was carrying was going for adoption, whether I liked it or not.
Because this was as a result of you making contact with the father?
Yeah.
What happened to your baby?
My baby went for adoption through St. Bridget's Orphanage. And I never heard of her again for 28 years. And in 1999, I registered on an online database, which was run by the Adopted Persons Association. And she had registered in around the same time. But it took a year because I actually put in the wrong date of birth. It took a year for us to discover a match. When I corrected my mistake on the date, I put the 24th instead of the 26th, I discovered the match. And I contacted the association and they made contact with her. And I was asked what information did I want her to be given. And I said everything that she wanted to know, my phone number, address and everything. And it was left up to her then when she would contact me. So about 2 months later, I got an email.
Okay, and this Christmas just gone. You were all together as a family.
Yeah, this Christmas just gone. I had all my children and my grandchildren. Became a grandmother to my subsequent children's children, two of them last year. So I had all my grandchildren and my children, and I saw my two daughters embrace for the first time.
I'm sure that was a great Christmas gift for you.
It was brilliant. It was a bit out of the body, but it was a very happy time.
Beside you, Cathy, we have Paul Redmond. Paul, your organisation is the Coalition of Mother and Baby Home Survivors, which is a group, a coming together of groups, if you like, in light of this commission. Your own story starts at Castle Pollard, is that right?
It does. I was born in Castle Pollard in 1964. There was money involved, so my mother wasn't in the place too long. Normally, women stayed in the home for 1 to 2 years to supposedly pay off their debt to the nuns.
So she may have been in there as a private
person. She was in as a private patient.
So her family were paying for her stay?
Yeah, it was £100 at the time, which is the equivalent of about £8,000 in today's money. Yeah, that was the cost. At 13 days, the two of us were transferred to St. Patrick's on the Navan Road. As soon as we reached the hall, I was taken from her arms and she was told to go and wait outside while the Sister Agnes rang her father, who came and collected her. I was sent to the wards for 4 days. There was a massive holding centre in St. Patrick's as well for over 500 babies and children, unaccompanied. And I stayed there for 4 days and I was adopted at 17 days old to a wonderful family, as most of us were. I think Ruth, who was also born in Castle Pollard, wanted to say something about that as well, because there should be something positive said. Most of us did go to very good families.
Okay, Ruth is sitting in front of you here. Yeah. Ruth, you were born in Castle Pollard as well.
Born in August 65.
Okay, and you were adopted from there? Or
I was born in 15th of August 1965. And my birth mother was from Tipperary. And I was adopted on November 65 by a wonderful couple from Dublin that actually had 6 children of their own. And they're my 2 sisters either side here, Martina and Elizabeth. And they adopted me. And being a mixed race child, it never ever bothered them. Mm-hmm. Colour never came into it. And I had a very positive adoption.
Well, that is the other side of the story, and I'm sure many people do have that story, but unfortunately, and Paul, you know, because you've done the research, there are thousands who don't have the happy ending that Ruth had.
That is true. Well, the vast majority of adoptees did go to good homes. Our prospective adoptive parents were vetted by social workers as a general rule, and we did go to good homes. The downside we're talking about is the fact that we all grew up with the knowledge that the adoption records were sealed in this country and remain sealed to this day. There was momentum to open them a couple of years ago from James Riley, and that's just stopped dead at the moment. Personally, I spent 33 years searching for my mother to get a single phone call of 40 minutes, and the poor woman is absolutely traumatised by her experience. She, without a doubt, suffering from post-traumatic stress disorder, as an awful lot of natural mums are to some extent or another. She has a full-scale memory blackout of the 2 weeks we spent together in Castle Pollard. And at the end of the phone call, I was basically politely told never to call again. That was 4 years ago, and I haven't. I've never, and there won't be any more contact. That's the end of it for me.
And the other side of this is the people that you represent, and the discovery that we know now happened in Tuam over the course of the last couple of months, news of which emerged last week. People are very divided, aren't they, about what should happen in Tuam?
They are. There are no simple and easy answers or sound bites to this. It is a highly complex and deeply emotional and sensitive issue. I know several mothers who lost their babies, whose babies died in mother and baby homes and who were buried in the homes. in some ways, I know one of them who considers herself one of the lucky ones, because she said she has something to actually deal with. She had her grief, she worked through it as best she could, and after she left the home, she got on with her life. And she simply doesn't want the angels' plots touched. She wants her baby to rest in peace. And a lot of people feel like that. Others are adamant that they have the right to have their babies or brothers or sisters exhumed and to be given a proper burial.
Okay, Clodagh, who's beside you from the group Beyond Adoption.
Beyond Adoption.
Is that your experience as well, that people are divided, as Paul says, about what should happen?
Firstly, thanks for having us here, Claire. I was born in St Patrick's, so the babies from St Patrick's are in Glasnevin, and they're in a plot of 50,000. Now, there's 2,500 that came from St Patrick's. So the St Patrick's people are kind of saying, don't be going in and digging up 50,000 bodies for 2,500 babies. Nobody has ever come to me looking for a site to be dug up. I would deal in Beyond Adoption, I would be the happier kind of side of adoption, that I would reunite adoptees with their birth mothers and fathers and siblings. But it is very divided. And certainly with, I can't speak for Castle Pollard, yes. The Bethany, yes. I don't think they want excavations. But I can't speak for Besborough or Ross Cray or Shan Ross Abbey. Absolutely not. Mm-hmm. Everybody's entitled to their own opinion and their own justice.
Niall Meehan is beside you. And lest anybody thinks that this is solely Catholic institutions that we're dealing with here, you did research into the Bethany home, isn't that right?
Yeah, in 2009-10, I got in touch with a survivor called Derek Leinster. And I got hold of the minutes of the Bethany Home Management Committee. It was a Protestant evangelical institution. And in Protestant communities, there was just as much control over unmarried mothers and their abandoned children as in the Catholic community. And the minutes of the institution indicated that there were children who were dying. We had no idea where they were buried. And we eventually traced them to Mount Jerome Cemetery, where we found that they were buried in unmarked graves. And we traced about 220 of the graves in 2010. And in 2014, Derek Leinster organised a memorial stone for the children who died. And this is a form of remembrance, because otherwise they would have been forgotten. I think it's important to understand this was part of an alliance between churches and the state, not just the Catholic Church, but also Protestant churches and the state itself, which is supposed to regulate these institutions. But we found in our research that the state wasn't interested in death and neglect. And in fact, an inspector went into the Bethany home and said at one stage, it's well known that illegitimate children are delicate. And he brushed aside the neglect and death of children at that time.
Yeah. They were dying at a greater rate because they were illegitimate and they might have been in some way vulnerable.
That inspector, Dr. Winslow Sterling Berry, was himself a medical doctor. And he did that in order to prevent squabbling between Catholics and Protestants about the Bethany home, tried to take attention away from it by ignoring the death and neglect and just talking about Catholics regulating their children, Protestants regulating their children, and in that way the state could absolve itself of its responsibility.
Handing over the problem.
Yeah.
So the over 200 bodies that were at Mount Jerome, were they all documented? Could you ascertain that that's where they were and this is who they were?
We had to go through the cemetery records, and through tracing the records from 1922 to 49, we traced all the children who came from the Bethany home, and as a result we could identify the children and get their names, and on that basis we could put up the memorial stone, because otherwise they would have been forgotten. They were destined to be forgotten. Some of the children were buried the day they died, so there couldn't have been much Christian ceremonial over their bodies at that stage. Okay. So we're interested also in the fact that children were sent on to other institutions, the West Bank Orphanage, the Nursery Rescue Society from the Church of Ireland Magdalen Home, and there they became free farm labour. And they had very blighted lives. And we feel that the remit of the Mother and Baby Home Commission is too narrow. I know the United Nations today called for it to be extended.
That's right.
And we're very much in favour of that.
Okay. Susan Lohan. Susan, where are you sitting? Adoption Rights Alliance.
Yeah.
And you would represent people who are, some of whom are ageing and need solutions now. Mm. What is there a message coming from those people that you represent as to what they want to see happening, or is it disparate, as we've heard earlier?
Well, I think for starters, we want to see the terms of reference extended. We made very strong objections to the narrow terms of reference when they were announced initially in 2015. And in fact, I was in Geneva 2 weeks ago as part of the group giving submissions to the CEDAW committee. And we're absolutely delighted that they've come out and spoken so strongly on the need for the Irish state to investigate what happened in the Magdalene laundries, what happened in the mother and baby homes. And that's come under the heading of access to justice. So they're very clear that people who spent time in those institutions have been denied access to justice.
OK, we asked our Clare Byrne Live and Morag panel that question, whether the terms of reference and the scope of the Mother and Baby Homes Commission of Investigation should be widened to include other homes and institutions. 88% said yes, 4% said no, and 8% don't know. So that's pretty resounding. And I know, Paul, you've been campaigning for that to happen as well. Do you think it will? What sort of noises are we hearing now in the last couple of days?
Well, we haven't got any indication from anybody yet. But what we can say for certain is that halfway through the inquiry, which was time limited to 3 years, which would have been about 5 or 6 months ago, the inquiry produced an interim report which it handed to Catherine Zappone, the Minister for Children. Catherine Zappone has basically been sitting on that for 5 months. Claire Daly, TD, who has been without a doubt the longest running support, political supporter of our cause, asked a question in the Dáil 2 weeks ago about that very issue, and Catherine's opponent just fobbed her off, blah, blah, blah. Okay, well, she's taken legal advice. But we're hopeful that there is something in that because
well,
we
things may change now given what has happened in the
Well, we hope so. The terms of reference desperately need to be expanded, and room was put into the original terms of reference by James Riley to expand the remit if the inquiry asked for it to be expanded.
OK, I want to come to David Kinsler, who's sitting just behind you there. David, you have a really interesting story. You were born in St Patrick's on the Navan Road. You weren't well as a child, isn't that right? You were hospitalised.
I wasn't, Claire, and very much thank you for having us here, and also to mention Catherine Carless, like, you know, relating to the Tuam babies. And what's very inspiring to me about the Tuam babies on a Friday when the news broke is that I was a near-dead baby as well. You know, I was born on St Patrick's Navan Road, and at four months old, I got the normal BCG vaccine that we all get as human beings. And 4 days later, I was anointed and confirmed. That was the start of a trail of illnesses throughout my medical records, which I have with me as well, that show. And I was hospitalised 6 times from St Patrick's to St Kevin's, which is now St James's Hospital, on 6 occasions. The last, in my fourth year, I was there for nearly 7 months, where I went through a blood transfusion and other tests. So it was a life, sort of a four-year struggle.
And tell us about the woman then, who worked in the hospital, who developed a bond with you as a little child.
Yes, my adoptive mother, Agnes Kinsella, a lovely lady, lovely woman. She worked as a cleaner in St Kevin's, which is now St James's. And because I became such a regular over the few years, here's that little child in again, like, you know. And there was an occasion on my records as well where I had leukemia as well. But it turned out to be some form of another disease. And she said, if he survives, like, you know, she was going to adopt me, and that's what happened. My adoption was delayed because I'd been chronically ill on and off. And she told me all this, you know, the wonderful woman my adoptive mother was. While I had a very strict upbringing in its own sense, she told me at the age of 20, when I was in having my first detox for alcoholism and prescription drug use.
Because you had, I mean, we should say you had great trouble in your life dealing with what had happened.
The emotional, my looking for my identity, genetic bewilderment, as we call it, like, you know. And, you know, I searched from a young age for her for many, many years, you know. And sadly, the Eastern Health Board, as it was many years ago, denied me access as to who she was, and no information. And then in the last recession in the 1980s, when I was working in London in British Rail, it turned out that she was only 10 minutes away in a tube, you know, mm-hmm. and that's heartening for me, like, you know, that I could have met her, like, you know, I could have met one of my four siblings, and
you have met some siblings now, is that right?
Yes, yeah. I did, Claire. I met Emma flew in from London in 2005 to meet me, and I'll always be very grateful to that, you know, and she's the image of my youngest daughter. She has a slight feature of myself, a beautiful young lady, and
so some of the missing links are falling into place,
yes,
for you, which I'm sure is some comfort to you. Just to come back to Tuam now, Councillor Peter Roach, where are you sitting, Peter?
Okay.
Fine Gael Councillor from Tuam. You're very welcome. Thank you. That's for being good. With us tonight. Often when something like this happens in a community, the community will have known beforehand that this was happening in their area. Do you think there was a sense of that in Tuam before we had the confirmation last week?
Very definitely, yeah. I mean, it the stories, I suppose, emanated probably about maybe 18 months ago. And, you know, probably as a consequence of Catherine Corliss's, you know, historical research. And, as you know, from there on, it certainly got legs, as it were. And, you know, a lot of people didn't want to believe that the stories of, you know, 700 or odd children in that home were factual, and I think last Friday's Commission of Investigation announcement confirmed that to be, you know, fairly close to the truth. And, you know, it has, Claire, it has left a lot of sadness, and people feel bereft and helpless.
And are there some who would just like to have this left alone and not disturbed, leave it to the past?
Yeah, some of your previous speakers mentioned that there's divided opinion on this. Yeah, there is quite an element of that, but there is one has also to consider what others are thinking, and that is, you know, that maybe the right thing to do would be to exhume the bodies and put them into consecrated ground. But one thing is sure, Claire, that what I would be hoping for is that not be one person's decision. And that not be rushed to, that, you know, there's a lot of stakeholders involved here. There's families, relatives, you know, there's the community that live close to the site in Tuam.
Well, we even get a sense of the complexity of the problem here tonight when we talk to people. But I want to turn now to our guest, Dermot Ferriter, who's Professor of Modern History at UCD. You're very welcome, Dermot. In 2014, you said that the assumption or the claims that there were 800 children in a septic tank in Tuam were erroneous. Do you still hold that view?
I don't know. And the reason I said that in 2014 when this story first broke was because of the work of Catherine Corliss, which needs to be applauded. And I said that at the time because what she did was the painstaking, methodical research that had to be done to establish that there were nearly 800 death certificates. And the big question then, of course, was where were the bodies? And Catherine Corliss herself at the time said that she was distressed and upset by the lurid headlines that were appearing nationally and internationally, because this story went around the world, and those headlines maintained that 800 babies' bodies were dumped in a septic tank in Tuam. And Catherine made the point that she had never made that claim, and she didn't know, and nobody knew at that stage, the extent of this or how many bodies we may have been dealing with. And the point I was making was not in any way to downplay the significance and the tragedy and the horror of this kind of story and this kind of revelation. It was to emphasise that we needed to have evidence before we could make claims about how many bodies were buried where.
And we still don't know.
And
the
we
numbers,
still don't know.
We've
been told. And
have.
I mean, and Paul summed it up there very well when he said that, you know, sound bites don't do justice to the complexity and the layers to these various stories. And that's why Catherine Corliss's approach was so exemplary in how she brought this into the public domain. But it was about going through, exhausting every avenue to try and get every bit of information that was available and could be found in the public domain. And that remains central to the challenge to get justice and to get to the truth. Where is the information on all of these homes? Does enough information exist to establish exactly what happened? Where exactly are the records? Who are the custodians of the records? What do those records tell us? When will they be in the public domain?
Do we understand what kind of a society created the conditions where such abandonment and neglect could happen and was treated or met by silence in most cases, or supported in many cases. As we know, the nuns weren't going around capturing people and taking them off the streets. The families involved, you know,
you say society, and you're right to say society. This is not about state, it's not about church. It, you know, it's about state, society and church. When Enda Kenny was responding to the McAleese report into the Magdalen Laundries in 2013, he referred to the solid public apparatus that exists, that it did exist, what historians have described as the architecture of containment, that you have all of these institutions all over the country that are hiding something and that are a convenient solution, or deemed to be a convenient solution to certain problems. And we had the Ryan Commission, which detailed abuse in 216 institutions and the industrial schools. We've had Magdalen, we now have this focus on the mother and baby homes. We had in this country an extraordinary range of institutions. It suited the state in many ways because, as it saw it, the church was dealing with these social problems. It was convenient for the state. And we have to acknowledge an uncomfortable reality. It also suited some families that they would not have to deal with the stigma that was associated with an unmarried mother. And you've got to remember, an archbishop, a Catholic archbishop of Tuam, at the foundation of the state, Dr. Thomas Gilmartin, and it's appropriate that he was from Tuam, he said that the future of the country was bound up with the dignity and the purity of Irish women. Now think about that. And if women were not deemed to be living up to that dignity and purity, this is what happened to many of them when they got pregnant. Okay. There's no shortage of fallen women in Irish history. That's what they were termed. They were sinners. They were hardened sinners. There was a language of criminality around them. They were offenders and repeat offenders. They were supposed to be kept apart from the respectable poor, which is very revealing about class in Ireland. You search in vain for the fallen men. It's very gendered. It's very much about targeting the women. And it's hugely ironic that a big part of this story is about women leaving this country. Because one of the reasons why this narrative developed from the 1920s was that we were supposed to be more chaste, we were supposed to be purer, we were supposed to be more devoted in our religious observance, and that we had to mark ourselves as being distinctive by treating these women so horribly and so harshly. There's a huge irony that so many ended up outside of Ireland and even integrating into families in Britain or creating a life in Britain. There's a great irony in that. And you've got to think about all of the different networks and power alliances that were keeping those institutions functioning, that were funding those institutions. There was a great silence about it, but it's also important to acknowledge that there were people raising questions at various stages. The mortality rates in these mother and baby homes at some stages were nearly four times higher than they were in the rest of the rest of the country when it came to infant mortality. Okay. So there were questions being raised by some inspectors, for example, in the Department of Local Government and Public Health. But the only way to get to the bottom of this is to get all of that information into the public domain. That's the only way you could get some kind of a resolution to the Magdalen Laundry issue, even though it's never fully resolved. You can't ever fully resolve these. You'll never be able to get all of the information you need and do justice to all of the individual stories. But as an exercise in public and political and societal responsibility, as much information as possible has to come into the public domain.
Okay, Dermot, and this is obviously the start of the conversation. You mentioned the tireless work of Catherine Corliss, and her work brought to light almost 800 death certificates relating to the home in Tuam in the period between 1925 and 1960. We've decided to show the names of each of the 796 children certified as having died there. Catherine Corliss has chosen the music for this special film.
Thank you.
the names of those children who are certified as having died at the Tuam mother and baby home. Anyone affected by these issues can contact the Samaritans anytime on the telephone number 116 123. The Tuam mother and baby home factual information line is 01647 3232. That's during office hours. Coming up after the break, an exclusive interview with the birth mother of Grace, the young girl at the centre of the South East foster care scandal. Welcome back. Tomorrow the Cabinet will publish the terms of reference of a new commission of inquiry about the South East foster care scandal. Now, last week we brought you an interview with the whistleblower at the centre of that case. She acted to protect Grace, a profoundly disabled girl who was in foster care. The HSE had stopped sending other children there due to allegations of abuse. Now, for the first time, Grace's birth mother has spoken out. Aoife Hegarty from the RTE Investigations Unit is here. Aoife, you're very welcome. Remind us first of all about Grace's case.
Well, Grace was born to a single mother in her teens in the late 1970s, but she was born with severe intellectual disabilities, and so her mother was unable to care for her and give her the kind of care that she needed. So she decided that in the best interests of her daughter that she would hand her over to the care of the state. Now, in the segment that we'll now hear from Grace's mother, she talks about that decision and putting her child into care and how she was always led to believe that Grace was in a happy environment with a loving foster family. That's something we now know not to be true. In fact, Grace's mother told us how there were clear opportunities to tell her about allegations of sexual abuse that surrounded this foster home, but they weren't taken up. For instance, they contacted Grace's mother in relation to consent for various medical procedures, but when it came to Grace having tests carried out for sexually transmitted diseases, her mother was not consulted. Now, Grace's mother is also concerned at her portrayal in the Conal Devine report as being uncontactable over a long period of time. She says, in fact, she's had the same telephone number for the past 30 years. Now, we've seen evidence today of Grace's file dating back as early as 1989, and that phone number appears in that file. Today, we tried that phone number and we got straight through to Grace's mother. So we'll have a listen now at some of what Grace's mother's had to say.
I was pregnant with Grace, and I was so young and I had no support and I was no fit state to look after her, so I put her in the care of the South Eastern Health Board, and I thought that was the best thing to do at the time, that she'd be well looked after and cared for. And and I always kept in contact. I had no reason to believe that she wasn't happy. A day didn't go by that I never thought of her. She's the first thing I think of in the morning and the last thing I think of at night. So she's constantly there with me, always, and always have been, and always will be.
What had been your understanding of where Grace was living and what her situation was like?
My understanding back then, before all the allegations, was that she was happy. She was attending her day services, and she was just in a loving, caring home. And that made me happy, knowing that she was happy. Because that's what I was made to believe. That's what I was always told.
And you did have some contact from the HSE over the years asking you for...
I did. I had contact. They were asking me for mandu testing and dental treatment. But they never contacted me when there was sexual allegations of sexual abuse, where I needed to give consent for STI testing. There was plenty of opportunities for Grace, where they failed to tell me. So I've got no faith whatsoever in anything they've got to say. Because all through Grace's life in the care of the HSE and the South Eastern Health Board, I was lied to constantly.
What contact details did they have for you throughout the years?
They've always had my contact details. I've had the same telephone number that I've had with the last 30 years, and I still have got that phone number to this day. And they've always had contact details. They've had my address. Yeah, they've always had my details. They still have my number on file if they went to look through it.
So Aoife, she says she was always contactable, but when did she discover that there were concerns in relation to this foster home?
Well, the first that Grace's mother learned of those sexual abuse allegations came out of the blue when a social worker phoned her in 2009. Up until that point, Claire, she had been totally unaware that there was anything of concern in relation to this foster home. Now, in this next segment that we'll hear from Grace's mother, she tells us what she was told during that phone call and what it was like to get that news about her daughter.
I was told that she was taken to hospital for get checked out, that there was bruises to her wrists and to her thighs, and I was totally devastated. Totally, totally devastated. Couldn't believe what I was hearing. I said I wanted her moved immediately. I thought, how could they do this? How could anyone cover up all this from me? And to keep her, you know, and have her in danger. It was just totally awful. I couldn't believe that. I felt very suicidal. I just wanted it all to go away. I couldn't believe what I was hearing. Even now, I can't read Freedom of Information. I just read clippets of it, and that's just enough to send me over the edge. I don't know when I'll be able to pick it up, and if I ever be able to read it, because the bits I did read was just too much to take in. And I won't rest, and I'll keep going until, and I want answers. I want answers, and I'm going to keep going till I get these answers. Because I've never gave up on my daughter, and I never ever will. She's always been in my mind, day and night, and that will never change. I will never stop fighting for justice.
A big decision for you to have your side of the story heard for the first time. Why have you decided to sit here today and do this?
I've sat here today because my daughter hasn't got a voice, and I'm here to give her that. I'm here for that voice for my daughter, and I just never want another child to suffer like that. Ever. I think it's wrong. It's wrong. And these people should be accounted for what they've done. For the cover-ups. For letting my daughter suffer for 20 years without monitoring her. And I put my trust and faith in the HSE, and that's what they've done. So I will not rest until I get answers. And I keep going till I get answers. The answers I never got, I want.
So Aoife, the Commission of Investigation will be getting underway soon, and I know that Grace's mother will be hoping to get the answers that she's looking for from that Commission of Investigation. But did she tell you what her hopes are, what will come from that?
Yeah, I mean, she sees this commission as kind of the last avenue for her now to get answers to all those questions she still has. Despite the fact that the Conal Divine and Resilience Ireland reports were published last week, she still feels in the dark about large chunks of her daughter's existence within that foster home. Now, in this clip that we'll hear now, she talks about exactly what those hopes are and what she hopes will be achieved from the Commission of Investigation. And she also talks about why she has rejected a written apology that she's received from the HSE.
I'm looking for all the answers that I asked, and just for them to be accountable for the letdown of my daughter Grace. Why they failed her? Why they never monitored her? Just basically why they left her for 20 years without checking up on her. They're the answers I want.
Who would you like held to account?
The people that failed my daughter. All the people that failed my daughter and the 47 other children that were meant to be in the care of the foster mother. I want them to be held accountable.
Have you ever received an apology for them, and you know, what's your feelings towards to those people now?
I got one letter there just a while back, but I felt in my heart it wasn't coming from the heart, but that, I don't accept that apology. No one from the HSEF picked up a phone and apologised to me or asked me how am I doing. Nobody have ever done that for me, and I don't accept their apology. I don't trust them. I don't trust what they have to say. You've told me that my daughter was doing great. She was in a loving home, which she wasn't in a loving home, and they knew all about her and never monitored her and left her there for 20 years to suffer.
Aoife, you've also interviewed a solicitor who has had contact with a number of people, families of loved ones who were in that foster home.
Yes, that solicitor, Sinead Carroll of Cantillon Solicitors, says that these families, the families of other people who spent time in that foster home, have been devastated simply by what's emerged about what happened there. And they are, just like Grace's mother, waiting for answers to so many questions that they still have. Now, in light of all that's come out in relation to this story, Sinead Carroll says that the only way real lessons can be learned going into the future and to ensure that the same mistakes aren't repeated time and time again is to introduce new legislation that will compel organisations just like the HSE to investigate complaints in an open manner and to admit to any mistakes that may have happened.
They want answers simply, and by that I mean a full and detailed investigation into what went on in this home, how any allegations were dealt with, and they just want to know what went on. And there has been some suggestion, as we all know, that there was a concealment of what went on, and they now want that uncovered, and they want to know who was involved, what steps were taken to protect their loved ones, or not taken, as the case may be. I think that one glaring thing that comes out of the Divine report in particular is that the HSE had a choice to make at some stage, and that was a choice between protecting those who went through this home and preventing further abuse, or protect the HSE. And I'm referring to a specific point in time where a decision could have been made to make a particular court application that would have removed a service user, a resident, from this home, which would have stopped the placement, and obviously that would have protected others. The decision was taken not to do that, and the report clearly notes the reason why was because the HSE would have to answer difficult questions. So it's there, it's black and white, it's blatant. The HSE chose itself, its reputation, over the care of the most vulnerable people in our society who placed their faith in the system. And that's absolutely devastating. What occurred in this home is abhorrent, and it's shocking, and it's horrid, but it's exacerbated and made all the more worse by the then what seems to be blatant concealment or cover-up, if you want to call it that, afterwards. So it seems that the only way that we can actually stop that and ensure that there's truth going forward is to introduce legislation to make it compulsory that if the HSE receive complaints or they come across adverse consequences, that they have to investigate it and they have to deal with the family members and notify them. And if they don't do that, I think it should be a criminal offence, and that's what needs to happen. It's radical, but it's clearly the only thing that's going to work so that we don't have this over and over again.
That's Sinead Carroll, solicitor there. But I gather, Aoife, that Grace's mother has met her daughter in recent weeks?
Yeah, just within recent weeks, Grace's mother met her daughter Grace for the first time in over 3.5 decades. So as you can imagine, that was a very emotional but a special day for her, because the last time she held her was at 18 months old. And in this clip that you'll now hear from her, she talks about that experience. You saw Grace recently.
I did. Yeah. It was very emotional, but it was lovely. It was a lovely day. Yeah, we took pictures, and it's the first thing, it's the last thing I look at night before I close my eyes. It's her pictures on my phone. Yeah, it was a lovely day. Seeing her, but it'll be the first of many days.
So what are the plans now going into the future? What are your plans for you and for Grace?
I hope I'll be in a better place when all this is over, to enjoy my time with her. That's what I'm hoping. But at the moment, I just cannot move on till I get all the answers that I want. I have felt that it's ruined my life. All this, I have. It's ruined my life. The lies. The constant lies. And the suffering of my daughter has ruined my life. I have. And I hope someday, like, that when they be held accounted for, and knowing that no one else is going to suffer again, that I can move on, be happy.
Aoife, the terms of reference for the Commission of Investigation will be published tomorrow. You've seen them tonight. You've also spoken to families of some of the other children who lived at that foster home. How have they reacted to all of this?
Yeah, well, the biggest feature of that those terms of reference is the fact that they will focus on the Grace case alone. Now, tonight, just before I came into studio, I spoke again to Sinead Carroll on behalf of that wider group of families, and she says they're extremely upset and disheartened to hear that the terms of reference will just be limited to one case alone. That's not appropriate in their view, and despite a recommendation in a recent report received by government by the senior counsel, Conor Dignam, that other cases should be looked into. She says that that has been completely ignored by the current government. Now, we do, however, understand that those terms of reference are just a first module, and the thinking behind that singular approach was that if they looked at all the cases now, this Commission of Investigation could go on for years, and therefore, you know, getting the answers would be delayed. So, you know, perhaps by doing this type of investigation, they'll get answers more quickly, and that might help future investigations into this foster home.
Okay, Aoife Hegarty, thank you very much for bringing us that tonight. I just want to turn to Christina Finn, who's here from thejournal.ie. Christina, I know you've been working on the Tuam story, but how does this story tonight feed in to all of that? We have another commission of inquiry now. We have other alleged victims who are not happy with the terms of reference of that commission of investigation.
Well, I think both cases are really linked when you look at the complacency of the state over decades. Particularly with the Grace case, this has been ongoing since a number of years now. We had Tony O'Brien out apologising in front of the Health Committee last year, and there was such a delay even getting these terms of reference off the ground. I know Finian McGrath was out today, the Junior Minister for Disabilities, to say that he was going to do everything he could for the Grace case. But since this has all come to light, there's been a multitude of other cases raised. We feature them a lot on thejournal.ie. I know a lot of people here tonight have heard of other stories relating to the HSE and, you know, Tuzlan allegations. And to perhaps narrow the terms of reference for the sake that it could be delayed in looking at other cases, I'm not sure that's going to fly with a lot of people. I think people want real answers at this point.
Okay. I want to come very finally to Terry Harrison, who's joined us here tonight. And Terry, we were having a chat before we came to air tonight. Just raise your hand so we can get a microphone to you there, Terry. Terry, you had your baby in the 70s. You never met your son. Unfortunately, we don't have time to hear the entire story. But what's your message? What do you want to have happen as a result of the conversation we're having now about people like you and your child?
Can I just say, Claire, on behalf of all the women I am representing tonight, we are a community of Irish females. We have been meeting since 1991 in hiding. And now, thanks to the Aisling Centre, we have a venue and we share our experiences. And what I want to say to the Irish people, please allow us to come out and speak about what happened to us in those institutions. Allow us the dignity, give us back our dignity by simply saying, sorry, it should never have happened. And we were wronged and we did no wrong. And I heard earlier about a lot of the mothers in my groups, we express the fear. For 22 years, I didn't even know if my son was alive. And I'm listening to Grace's mummy. And it's horrible. It's horrible. But to hear the stories of some people, like David sitting next to me, Paul, Claudia, Susan, we love to hear that our children were loved and cared for. But that was not part of our consent. It wasn't an open consent. Our children were taken from us. So please bear in mind, my son, I named Niall, he doesn't know that name. I've lived with him my whole life for 44 years, and I'm still waiting on him to walk in that door as my son. And strange as it might seem, I have a lady who's 85 years of age this year. 67 years she's waiting for her son. We never gave them away. They were taken. There's a huge difference.
Terry, thank you so much.
Thank you.
A powerful contribution. Look, that's all we have time for tonight. A special thanks to all of our guests who are so brave tonight. You'll find me back on RT Radio 1 on Saturday afternoon as usual. Join me here next Monday night for more debate and discussion. For now, though, a very good night to you all. Good night.